Good afternoon and welcome to Ely Cathedral for this service of Choral Evensong on All Saints Sunday. Extremely glad to have the Procale Cantoris leading the music of the services over this weekend and again for this service. Seeing that we are compassed around with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us, and run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith.
Oh, The first lesson is written in the prophecy of Isaiah. I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord's, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Here endeth the lesson.
Thank you. Second lesson is written in the letter to the Hebrews. And what more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death, they were sawn in two, they were killed by the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. Yet all these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better so that they would not, without us, be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who, for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Here endeth the lesson.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy. in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys which thou hast prepared for them that unfeignedly love thee. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
An interesting similarity between tonight's readings is that no one is sure who wrote either of them. The prophet Isaiah probably did not write the final chapters of the book to which his name is ascribed. Likewise, we don't know who wrote the letter to the Hebrews. It almost certainly wasn't St. Paul. An important difference between the readings is that the prophecy of Isaiah, written centuries before Christ, was looking to the future. The author of Hebrews, writing a few decades after the resurrection, was looking back many centuries, at least in most of the passage, to the lives of great men of faith. Some of these, and many others, were mistreated or even killed for their faith. The same was true for the early Christians to whom the letter was written, and indeed for many Christians down to the present day. When I first looked at the lesson from Isaiah, two things struck me. The first, perhaps a little flippant. Isaiah's vision of the future reminded me of campaign promises made by political parties at local and national levels. They promise, for example, more spending on education and health, improved public transport, a cleaner environment, and so on. The politicians want our votes now, of course. Isaiah was urging people to turn to God. Secondly, there are similarities with passages in Revelation and Micah. Micah writes in words often heard on Remembrance Sunday, "Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid." Revelation chapter 21 begins, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away." Very similar words to those from our first reading from Isaiah, "For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth." Isaiah foretells a time is coming when the Lord's faithful people will know peace. It will be a time of renewal and tranquility. People can build houses and know that they can live in them. They can plant vineyards, knowing they can eat their fruit. The wolf and the lion will lie down together. I often have to remind myself that life in the land and times of the Bible was very different from our lives today. Thousands of years ago, few people lived beyond 50. So it was quite something to say that someone who reached 100th birthday would be considered young. Infant mortality and childhood disease were so great that only about 1 in 4 live births made it to adulthood. For people who lived in a world where childbearing was fraught with danger, it's no wonder a world where birthing was easy was considered paradise. Isaiah was looking to the coming of Christ and beyond. It was written in language and terminology which the readers would understand. The author of Hebrews is clear that the Old Testament men and women of faith, some writers call them heroes, trusted in the promises of God, but they did not receive God's promises. The Hebrews and all Christians down the ages have also received the promises. But we have the advantage of knowing that they were fulfilled in Christ, as foretold by Isaiah. Isaiah wrote of covenants a number of times. Earlier in Hebrews, the author writes about the household of God consisting of the faithful participants in the Old Covenant and members of the New Covenant. And in chapter 16 we read, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. I will be their God, and they will be my people. The Old Testament heroes waited for the promise of the new covenant to be fulfilled. None of them ever saw it in their lives. They lived in a time of expectation. We, however, live in a time of fulfillment. The new covenant is here. God's promises find their ultimate fulfillment in Jesus, who spoke of the new covenant at the Last Supper when he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you." Virtually the same words spoken by Canon Martin in this morning's Eucharistic prayer. Isaiah's message was one of hope and encouragement. That of the Hebrews, less straightforward. But the Hebrew Christians had the new covenant, and like us, were waiting for the fulfillment of it. If Old Testament believers could live by faith in the light they had, how much more should we live by faith, seeing we have more fulfilled promises than they? Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we join our praises with all who have kept the faith, all who have been loyal and true, all who have served and witnessed, all who have been holy and examples to us. Lord, make your church a holy church, a praying church, a serving church. We give thanks for the saints who have inspired us. May we be an inspiration to others. Holy God, make us holy. We remember and give thanks for all who have sacrificed and laid down their lives for others. We pray for all who are seeking to live in simplicity, all who are leading dedicated lives, all who are giving themselves on behalf of others, all who give of their time and talents in the service of humanity. Holy God, make us holy. We give thanks for all who have led us into the ways of holiness, for all who have shared their vision and their love. Bless, O Lord, our homes, that they may be revelations of your love. Holy God, make us holy. We pray for all who are living heroic lives amidst troubles. Lord, that the weak may know your strength, that the troubled may know your peace, that the fearful may know your love, that the lonely may know your presence. Lord, may all who are in need know that you protect them and enfold them in your love. Holy God, make us holy. We rejoice in the fellowship of all your saints with all the faithful departed. We give thanks that we are surrounded by their prayers as we journey on. Like them, Holy God, make us holy. Holy Lord, take us and make us holy. Make us yours and make us obedient. Make us faithful, make us joyful, and make us to be numbered with your saints in that glory which is everlasting. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we gather these and all our prayers together in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Thank you.
God, who has prepared for us a city with eternal foundations, give you grace to share the inheritance of the saints in glory, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.